Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to one more game of Cairns Cup 2020. And I wanted to show you today some games from the Prague International Chess Festival. However, we have much more important news from Cairns Cup, from St. Louis, Missouri, USA, because a 16 years old Carissa Yip, I just showed her two games before, and now I have to show one more game, because she just won against Wenjun, so actual world champion, women world champion. So pretty impressive stuff just happened. This is why I decided to show this game first. And about Carissa Yip, she's 16 years old and she is known because she played really great chess, and in the age of 10 she won against her first grandmaster opponent, which was of course very impressive, and now her ranking is 2412, and she played as black against Wenjun. And Wenjun is number 2 by ranking in the world, and as I said, she is the world champion and 28 years old and actual ranking 2583. Okay, so without further ado, let's jump into the game. E4 by Wenjun and E5 by Carissa Yip. Knight F3, Knight C6, Bishop B5, so Ruy Lopez on the board, A6, Bishop a4, and now g6 by Carissa, and here I'm not c3 preparing, but first d4. So this is line where white gonna sacrifice the pawn for the exchange, and this is a Morphy defense and Fianchetto defense deferred, so this Fianchetto gonna be important in that game. So we have e takes on d4, c3, so offering another pawn, but we have bishop on g7, so Carissa don't take that pawn, and here we have c takes on d4, b5 kicking the bishop, bishop b3, and now knight g on e7. We have d5 now, kicking that knight to a5, so knight go to a5. It could go also on e5, but a5 was chosen here, and bishop d2, so the knight is attacked. Knight on b3, and queen takes on b3, and here we have c5. D6 can be played, but c5 is chosen by Carissa Yip. And here d takes on c6 is possible, and after d takes on c6 we would have bishop on c3, bishop on e6, kicking the queen and queen b4, and after castling by both sides, the game would be pretty equal, and that was the possibility. But bishop on c3 was played, so Wenjun let this Benoni-like a pawn structure to have advantage on the queen side, while she has advantage in the center, so both sides have to be very careful and definitely has to know what they are doing. We have f6, so it looks like it's well-known position for Carissa. She knows what she is doing. Usually f6 is not played so early, and here the most popular but not the best move in the position is d6, and after knight on c6, queen d5 b4, kicking the bishop, very important one, bishop on d2 and bishop b7, queen can take on c5, but then we would have f5 with the attack on b2, and it's really not easy to defend that pawn as the b4 pawn controls, for example, c3. Of course, the position is playable, but in database all the games were won by black, so this is why usually first a3 is considered as the better move, because now b4 can't be played, and now d6 is a very, very serious threat. This is why Carissa play d6 herself, and here h4, and this is I don't have this move in the database, at least on leeches.org, but h4 probably preparing h5, but mostly like want to scare Carissa to castle on the king side and probably attack in the center, open the center and checkmate in the center. But Carissa just definitely know the position, so she just castle. We have knight b on d2, so Wenjun didn't go for h5, which would be maybe the most interesting idea in this position, but knight b on d2. We have queen on e8 and castle by Wenjun, so she play h4, but then she castle, so she didn't follow that plan. And we have bishop on d7, queen c2 by Wenjun, and rook c8. And here we have b3, so preventing any c4 moves. We have h6, so stabilizing the structure of pawns. Now these pawns can be moved forward if needed. And here we have a4, so Wenjun want to, you know, solve the problem on the queen side now. And after rook on a8, she just actually exchanged the pieces and want to control on a5. So we have queen on a8 and now rook a1. So for this moment, actually, Wenjun control on the open a-file. We have queen on b7, and here is the position where white actually stands better, but now have to show white's better. So feel free to, you know, pause the video and try to find the best continuation. It's not any tactic, it's just improving the position of the pieces where white can really, really stand much better while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? It's not really easy to find. If you find, for example, queen a2, then congratulations, you are as strong as the woman world champion, Wenjun. She play queen a2. But b4 is much more stronger move. Now, if black decide, for example, to play c4, which looks quite attractive, then white actually can play on d4 square. So knight can jump here, bishop can go here, and a lot of stuff can happening from d4. That's the extra base, and it can be attacked, actually, only can be attacked by the bishop, maybe in the future by this knight, but it's not easy because from where all the squares are controlled by white so far. So for example, rook a5, and white can start to organize the attack on a b5 pawn. So for example, knight on c8, h5, solving all the problems and counterplay on the king side, g5, and now knight f1, knight b6, and now bishop on d4. So getting advantage of this square, and after rook on c8, for example, knight e3, and now knight can jump to f5 and threat, doing some nasty threats. And also, if this bishop exchange for the knight, then there is less defender on b5, so b5 would probably fall, and soon after c4 would fall, so white would stand much better. And if after b4 c4 is not pushed, for example, queen on b6 is played, then knight can be remaneuvered to slightly different way. For example, knight on f1, h5, preventing the h5, knight g3, knight c8, and knight e2, bishop on g4, and now, for example, knight on f4, now with attacking chances also on the king side, but also it's still playable to, you know, attack the b5 weakness in white position. So this continuation with b4, if you found it, then congratulations, you fill the position, and you see what's important, how to take advantage in that position. Queen on a2, A queen on a2 was played, but that's not enough. So Wenjun in this position want to, you know, play on the open a file, which it's not really easy. Now we have knight on c8, so preventing coming of the queen to a7, to the 7th rank, what would be the most dangerous. And now we have remaneuvering the knight. So knight goes on e1, very early one, but it's quite important to do something with this knight. And here we have b4. B4 forcing bishop to b2, and now this knight can be remaneuvered to some places, but there is a difference where it should be. So bishop on b5 is played, preventing, for example, from moves like d3, and now the best idea to do something with this knight would be, for example, g3 and knight on g2. So for example, f5, knight g2, and now if f takes on e4, we would have bishop on g7, king g7, and only now knight e4. Then queen d5, queen b2 with check, and now if kings go on h7, then there is the line knight f6, forking the king and the queen. So a rook has to be sacrificed here, and then queen f6, bishop c6, threatening the checkmate. So f3 would be forced, and after exchanging the pieces, the position would be equal, and white has the exchange extra, but in the cost of two pawns, so it's playable for both sides. And also, if this king is not moved to h7 or g8, then queen on d4 would have to be played, and after exchanging, black structure would be messed up, and of course white has two knights, so can try to pick up all these pawns. So its position is also equal, but probably white would be more comfortable in playing that. But Wenjun didn't go for this g3 and knight g2 plan. She preferred to play knight on c2. Knight on c2, with the plan of knight on e3, and then these knights could control c4 square, which is quite important. If c4 is pushed, then that can be quite dangerous in the future. So we have knight on c2. We have also bishop on d3, so coming inside of the to the white territory, and we have knight on e3 as planned. And here queen on e7. Probably f5 could be interesting, but Carissa Yip didn't want to open the position yet, so f5 could be interesting, and after exchanging the bishop, queen could takes on g7, e takes on f5, g takes on f5, and after knight on e, e to c4, then black actually would have quite strong attack on the king, so that would be interesting option for black, and all white pieces are on the queen side, so maybe that would be the way to go. But Carissa Yip choose a more positional move, queen on e7. So she just play a good chess here. And here we have rook on e1. Rook on e1, so moving the rook from the a file. So now we have immediately knight on b6. Knight on b6, so of course rook on a8 is coming now. We have queen on a1, so I have to move the queen deep inside the white territory, and we have rook on a8, queen c1, and here we have h5 first. H5 actually is preparing the bishop to move on h6, and now asking the knights, what guys are you doing here? You are staying on this diagonal, but there is also the queen on that diagonal. So that's gonna be, you know, quite a difficult position for white. And here we have knight e2. to c4. Knight takes on c4, knight takes on c4, and now rook on a2. So it looks like 16 years old teenager, you know, outplay the actual world champion. It's pretty amazing, really. g3. And now, after exchanging the knights are no longer on this diagonal, so bishop on h6 is impossible to play, so king on h7 first. And here, there is actually only one move, so feel free to pause the video and find the only one move. I will switch the chessboard and try to find the only move for white which still, you know, keep white in the game. And it's pretty interesting. If you find this, then congratulations. But it's really, really not easy to find. And white running out of moves. If you start to analyze this position, then really not easy to find the move for white. While I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, so first I show you what will happen if some moves, like for example knight on e3 is played. So knight e3, we would have bishop on h6, queen d1 attacking the bishop, but then we would have queen on e4. And after bishop on f6, bishop b5, and black stands much better here. So not really great way to go. If queen on d2 is played, is even maybe not worse, but in similar fashion. B takes on c4 could be played, bc4, and now this pawn is passed pawn, of course protected, passed pawn very strong. And now f5 is enough here, e5 has to be played. Now this is a pretty nasty stuff, so e5 has to be played, and after d on e5, queen c1, and now e4, and after bishop on g7 and queen on g7, rook d1, so now you can try to push, but it's not really enough. Queen c3, and after exchanging stuff, rook c1 has to be played. This would be very dangerous. Rook a3 and d6, but then rook e6, and of course it can't be pushed because gonna be catch. It also can't be supported because of c2. So after exchanging, black would have easier to win, more active rook endings, and of course with extra pawn, so that would be easily winning. Now to find the move like this one, a rook on e3, congratulations, you are able to actually maybe even defend against 16 years old teenager. Bishop on h6, it's the move which, you know, probably prevent you from playing this rook on e3. But look what would happen. Bishop on h6, of course, f4 now. And now bishop on e4 can be played, and now what you had to find is queen on b1. Totally crazy move, attacking the rook and getting on the harm way on the of the bishop. And now of course if bishop takes, we would have rook on e7, king g8, and bishop f6, and for example, bishop f8, rook d7, and a bishop f5 attacking the rook, and black stands slightly better, but white has a lot of counterplay now. This pawn can't be easily attacked because of this this knight for now, and also this knight attacks the d6, so this is very flexible blocker, the best blocker ever. So it's very dangerous for d6 pawn, and that was the chance for white. And from the other hand, after queen on b1, also rook on b2 could be a played, sacrificing the exchange, but that would not work. Queen b2, f5, and then king h2, bishop g7, and queen c2. And of course that can be taken because for the same reason. So bishop on f8 protecting, and the game could continue, but it's pretty equal now. Black will probably not find the way, and white actually has the exchange extra, so that was not the way. So in this position, rook on e3 should be played, but it wasn't. In this position, actually, knight on d2 was played. And now it's a different story. Bishop on h6 by Carissa Yip. And now we have f4. So everything looks very similar. However, now we have queen on a7, putting the queen on this diagonal. Probably king g2 could be slightly better. Here, for example, king g2, and after bishop on g7, then knight on c4. But the position wouldn't be changed so much. So after queen e7, we have knight on c4, so preventing from moving on c4, pushing c4. And here we have queen d7 by Carissa Yip. And here we have rook on e3, and it looks like Zhu Wenjun got the similar position in the different move order, but it's slightly different, and actually it's a lot different. Now we have bishop on c4, b takes on c4, so black already got advantage of the protected passed pawn, and queen on g4 now. So queen on g4, very powerful move. However, it was possible to play bishop on f4 first. And I think Carissa didn't miss that tactic, just she was not sure about the tempos on the king, and I will show you why. G takes on f4, queen g4, that could be played, and after king on f1, queen f4 with check. And now if kings go on g1 or g2, doesn't really matter, rook on b2 can be played, queen b2, and queen e3, and then queen f6, and then tempo on queen e4 with check. So black stands better, two pawns extra, and of course winning position, but probably that would be very long queen's ending. Or if the king is actually moved on g1, that would be even better for black, because after rook on b2, and picking up the rooks, then king f1, because king is under attack now, and then queen f4 first with check, king g1, and now queen can pick up h4 pawn and protect the f6. So f6 can't be taken, and now black actually has 3 pawns extra, so even better. However, she just played queen on g4. And now Zhu Wenjun didn't want to get, you know, attacked by this, but by this tactic. It looks like very, very scary. And she play king on h1, and king on h1 is actually the last losing move. This is the blunder. But it's not easy to defend. Actually, the only way it would be possible is rook on d3. Rook on d3, defending the f4. And after bishop on f4, for example, queen f4 and queen f4 and gf4, rook b2. It's still better for black, but white would have some possibilities of playing. For example, e5, f takes on e5, f takes on e5, and white would have some serious counterplay. And of course, after rook d3, this don't need to be taken. Also, f5 can be played. And after e5, d takes on e5, and queen b1 attacking the rook. And now e4 also attacking the rook. And after rook on b3, rook a6 and bishop e5, the position is much better for black, but it would still be playable maybe. At least white would have some counterplay with the passed pawn. With the move king on h1, actually is all end. But the problem is that Zhu Wenjun in this position has only 3 minutes on the clock, so she has to decide what to play. And it was, as you see, it was not easy to calculate all these lines in this position. She spent a lot of time on the moves before. That's why that was the very problematic to find the right move now, which also didn't guarantee of, you know, staying in the game. And here, of course, we have bishop on f4, like before, g takes on f4, queen h4 with check now, king on g1, now we have queen g4 with check again, king h1, and now queen f4, so picking up all the material, and now queen b1. Rook on b2, queen takes on b2, and queen e3, so very similar situation. Now queen on f6, and actually we have a nearly the same position like we could have before after this sacrifice, but now queen on e4 with check, and 3 pawns extra, of course. White gonna lose the game. However, Wenjun still try to play. King on h2, and now we have b3. Queen and f7 with check. Now the king start the journey. So king h6, queen f8, king g5, queen d8 with check, king f5, queen d7 with check, king e5, now queen g7 with check, king f4, queen f6 with check, king g4, now queen e6 with check and attack on the queen, and now if queen takes on e6, it's also winning. However, that's a much more complicated, because after exchanging, then we would have the another queen ending with 3 pawns extra, but it's still a lot to do here. So actually queen f5 was played by Carissa, much more solid move, of course, and here we have queen on d6, so trying to create the passed pawn as the only chance for getting any counterplay, but Carissa actually don't give any opportunities. All she has to do now is exchange the queens, and she do it this way: queen f2 with check, king h1, queen f3 with check, king h2, queen h3 with check, king g1, and queen on g3 with check and attack on the queen. And in this position, Wenjun, a world champion, resigned the game against 16 years old Carissa Yip. So very huge congratulations to Carissa Yip, and it's a tremendous achievement, you know, to beat the world champion in the age of 16. And also remember that she lost 4 games in a row. So she had a 0 out of 4 in the first 4 games. She was defeated. And then she started to play really well, and she won actually 3 games already, so pretty well. Probably she was very nervous at the beginning of the tournament, but now she is playing her good chess. And why Wenjun resigned? Because after exchanging, of course, is nothing to do for her. D6, B2, and checkmate is coming. So king F1, and now we have queen, and of course completely winning game. So that's why. Okay, so thank you for watching, and if you like this video, press like, and if you don't like for some reason the video, press unlike, and leave the comment, what do you think about young Carissa Yip? For me, she is really, really impressive, and as I told you, she defeated the first grandmaster in the age of 10, and now she defeated world champion, woman world champion, when she is 16. So very, very impressive stuff. That's why I cover her third game in the row. So yeah, thanks for watching, and if you don't want to miss any other games from Cairns Cup, just press subscribe, hit the bell button, and yeah, see you in the next one.